as a firm. We are a behavior change agency. The holy grail of communications is when you can start to change behavior. Turn it out, this is a great, interesting case history of how we look at problems. There are two main political parties, one for the blacks and one for the Indians. And, you know, they screw each other. So we were working for the Indians. We went to the client and we said, we want to target the youth. And we try and increase apathy. The campaign had to be non-political because the kids don't care about politics. It had to be reactive because they're lazy. So we came up with this campaign, which was all about be part of the gang, do something cool, be part of a movement. And it was called the Do So campaign.
It means I'm not going to vote.
Do so, don't vote.
The salute of resistance that is known to all across Trinidad and Tobago. Do so, do so, do so.
It's a sign of resistance against, not the government, against politics and voting and stuff. They're making their own YouTube videos. This is the Prime Minister's house. It's being graffitied. It was carnage. We knew that when it came to voting, all the Afro-Caribbean kids wouldn't vote, because they do so. But all the Indian kids would do what their parents told them to do, which is go out and vote. They had a lot of fun doing this. But they're not going to go against their parents' will.
Thank God for the guidance that has brought us here to this retreat. Thank you. Thank you, God.
And the difference in 18 to 35-year-old turnout was like 40%. And that swung the election about 6%, which was all we needed in a, you know, election that's very close. We now undertake 10 national campaigns for prime minister or president each year. Malaysia, we're working in.
We did Lithuania, Kenya, Romania, Kenya,
and Ghana.
So
quite a few this
Nigeria.
Year.
Nigeria.
Brexit campaign.
Oh, and the Brexit campaign. Yeah.
Okay.
We don't talk
Brexit.
About that.
Oops, we won.
Where we said we want to target the youth. And we try to increase apathy, the feeling of helplessness and negative emotion. So they try to make them non-political because these kids, it has to be reactive because they're lazy. I mean, these are the perspectives that these companies have on people, on you guys, on how you will elect people. All of this, you can see it in the Great Hack documentary. So we just move on since we don't have sound. Sorry about that. The good news is that this data can also be used to empower you. You remember when you had to type in the lock code for your phone, and then now you use your personal data, your fingerprint, but it's encrypted, it's safely stored on your phone, so that you can open up your phone with only like tapping it. So that's an example of one kind of improvement that you can have, but there's tons of others. Like this ring here, that helped me. I'm an entrepreneur, I don't sleep that much. I have tons of problems. It collects sleep data, so now I know how to sleep properly. These are all empowering things that the data can do for us. I'm gonna do a crazy prediction really fast, because that's important as well. Natural resources, oil, has this kind of periodic table that makes up new elements and so on. What I'm gonna think in the future is that for digital resources, we might have something similar, like a periodic table of data points. Different elements that you can combine together to form new compounds that can create new insights that can be used by large companies. This is the value that all these companies are collecting and we're giving to them for free. So let's quickly summarize. Natural resources, you have oil as the best example. Digital resources, that would be data, right? This is the model that we have for natural resources. That's what we use today. This is the model that we have for digital resources. This is kind of a problem. And what we kind of want to do is we want to take this model and somehow make it useful for us as people, right? We want to take all that data that we provide and get some of it in return. That makes sense, right? All the value created, we should get some of it in return. The data can be used to manipulate, but what it should be used for is to empower. That's what we should focus on, and that's how this fits into regulation, right? So you have regulation should have the aim to minimize manipulation done through data and maximize empowerment done through data. And education, I believe, is a necessary precursor of regulation. And I don't know anyone else who I could introduce now that would be more perfect to go more in depth on data education than my co-founder Magnus. He's amazing, and we've been working together for years. He's been closing so many important deals, like one of them with Plan Norway for Uganda. And he's going to cover a little bit about what we do in education. So give him a warm welcome, round of applause. Thank you, Max.
Thank you for that brilliant warm-up there. And we came off with what the problem was. We came off with an idea of the solution. But what is that solution? Can anyone already point that out? Has anyone really been into the research before this presentation? What is one of the solutions out there for this huge problem? Well, it's a good thing you're here. So, there's different ways that we can learn from people. Learn from our devices, our browsers, our laptops, our mobile phones. And one of the things that we can do is, you know, I want my device to recognize my voice. Can you help me? This is a common problem that users have when people want to use Siri. You want Siri to actually understand you and do things that you want, not just get confused whenever you ask for something, right? So we need to have data from people to operate. Simple as that. You know, recommendations for content, treatment from a wearable device data like Simon's ring for his sleepness. But the problem is that we have this approach today. This is Google, Facebook, Yahoo, Amazon. It's called the centralized approach. It's efficient at access and processing your data. But we lack control over it. And it's vulnerable to attacks. For example, did you know that Twitter released the location of Julian Assange? And Julian Assange had no idea about that. And they were forced to do that by the government. And as well, Yahoo data breach, 3 billion users. And I don't need to talk about Facebook, everyone knows about that, right? It's also a costly infrastructure for the service provider. So it's costly for us as users. So Facebook disaster, how centralized systems have failed us. 50 million users. Users are deleting their Facebook accounts, investors dumping Facebook shares, and widely read tutorials. It's come to discussion of moral leadership, and we don't know if these companies are up for the challenge of this ethical problem. Yahoo as well, 3 billion users hacked, multiple times. So the question becomes, is decentralization the next big step for the World Wide Web? So, if the servers of these entities go down, we lose access to vital functionality. YouTube goes down, everything is lost. If they get hacked, we lose our data. If they decide to monetize our data in unlawful ways or hand it over to government agencies like the Julian Assange case, we have no right to even know about it. And if they decide to censor or prioritize content based on their interest, well, we can't do anything about that either. So, if anyone's familiar with Tim Berners, he invented the internet not too long ago, and he's actually in charge of a new campaign. He has called upon to assemble the brightest minds from business, tech, government, civil society, the arts, and academics to tackle this very problem. It threatens the World Wide Web, his invention. So, at the Decentralized Web Summit a few months ago, Tim Berners-Lee, who created the World Wide Web, was meeting in San Francisco to discuss a grand idea to circumvent internet gatekeepers like Google and Facebook. And they did discuss the solution was the Decentralized Web. Much like Bitcoin, decentralized internet has no central governing body. Nobody gets the right to dictate the main operations of the internet. The building blocks to this are known as dApps. So this is a little bit like what this looks like. This is a decentralized architecture where personal data stays on the user's device. And peer-to-peer communications without a central server is how it operates. So they run on a decentralized network, and I'm not going to get too into the details, but basically everyone has their own server that contributes to running the web in this version, in this solution. So the knowledge required to really know what a decentralized system works and why that matters is a little bit far away from the current knowledge that you get from education right now. So one of the things you'd have to know is what a blockchain is and why do we care? Because if we're going to adopt this new system, we're going to have to learn a few new things about what it means to actually have full control over our data. And blockchain is the central part of that, of decentralization. So it's a protocol designed to allow transactions across a distributed network without the need of a broker overseeing the process. So it doesn't have to be observed by anyone. So, who understands blockchain? Okay. Because I hear a lot of talks about blockchain and people use this word all the time, but they never explain it. So I feel like I'm just going to explain for a very brief amount of time what blockchain is. So each block has a data point, it's got a hash, and it's got a hash of a previous block. Okay, so what's a hash? And what is the data that's stored? So the store could have a little bit of information about the user from to and the amount. So that's the kind of data it can store. And the hash is like the ID number, that's why you see a fingerprint. And the hash of the previous block is the other fingerprint, and that creates a chain. And now you've got a chain linking together different pieces of data, different IDs, and you can also store the previous hash. So it's got these three different points in the chain. And the first block is called the Genesis block. Now, this is a system that stores each piece of information sequentially. The problem with this system is that a hacker can jump in and can change the hash number. And if this hash number gets changed from one of the blocks, well, the block after that will realize, because it contains the previous hash, that this block is not right. So that's one way of saying, okay, this data point does not make sense, it's been tampered with. So it's actually very easy for a hacker to tamper with all the blocks in front of that block. So you have something called proof of work. This is the concept why Bitcoin uses so much electricity, takes so much power, because it takes about 10 minutes to actually generate the crack of the code. So it takes a lot of power to generate the hash, 10 minutes. And that's why if a hacker hacks into this one and hacks into this one, it would take a very long time if the chain is very long, to actually get that right. And similarly, every person's hash code has to agree with each other. So everyone gets their own chain. If you imagine a billion users online, everyone has their own chain, and all of those chains have to agree with each other, which is what makes this so difficult to hash, to hack together. And the brilliant thing about that is, you don't need someone overseeing the data to verify it's correct. This is all done automatically. Which means you don't need someone like Google, you don't need someone like Amazon, you don't need someone like Facebook. And a new ideology is very difficult to like. Why? Because it's hard to understand, and if it's hard to understand, it's hard to appreciate. Right? So, the fact is that no one is going to adopt it unless we fully appreciate it and understand it. That's the catch-22 of the system. So the big companies are going to just, you know, keep on doing what they're doing, taking advantage of the system, until people get smart and realize what's going on. That's it. And since these are very new technologies, it takes a lot of effort to do that. So that's why we introduced Digit Academy. We look upon learning as boring and necessarily hard, but we want to facilitate 10x learning experiences. And we have a highly ambitious team working at Forskningsbanken for the past 2 years with various talents and skills as mentors, developers, scientists. And we've been creating this big data approach to educational technology. So I'll ask you a question. Does anyone know what this big data thing is? Just take a guess.
Yes.
It's something to do with education and data, and it's big.
Your understanding levels?
Yes, it's definitely related to that, yes. So, gentleman in the front said understanding level, and basically these are all different, the red, all different incorrect partial solutions, and the green are the correct solutions. And it's represented like a tree structure, because you can go in so many different directions when you're learning, right? And if you really want to personalize education, you have to be able to look at every different way a person can learn, so you can give them feedback on the way, so that they can get to their solution that's unique for them. And one thing that we've been researching, for example, this is a question from the University of Oslo. It's a mathematical question. I'm going to go through it quick. This is the exercise you get. This is what it looks like in code format. Just take my word for it. And we create a tree out of the solution. Every possible step is converted into a tree. And we do the same for the solution. And we do the same for multiple solutions as well. And then we have the solution over here, and we have the student solution, and we subtract the two together. So we can find out what the hint, the difference between the solution and the student solution is. And this is one of the steps to actually personalize education. So one of the times we utilized automatic feedback was in Uganda a couple months ago. We taught web design and computer science to students that had never learned computer science before. And we got some.
I was doing nothing, just staying at home, just doing with my fellows. Time came and my fellows had to join school, and I was just stuck. I never knew anything about the computer. I just knew it's a computer. I cannot place a key on it.
Smart Hub is a youth innovation space we created about 3 years ago to be able to create an opportunity for young people living in slum areas to be able to create ideas and innovation that can help them solve community challenges. So we train courses in entrepreneurship, programming, web development, application development, robotics, as well as life skills sessions like sexual health, gender education, among several.
My name is Aloya Flavia. I'm 27 years old. Currently, I take full responsibility of Smart Hub Factory, Gulu Hub. Smart Hub to come to Gulu basically because Gulu is a very big community which has a lot of youth who are redundant. And then being the fact that we suffered war for 20 years, people never had opportunities to bring the youth together to innovate, to come up with their innovative ideas and prototype them.
When I joined Smart Hub with the various skills that I've been learning, and they told us to go and do research on the problems that people are facing in the community. So for me, I see that most of the brothers are being killed, and their motorcycles are also being taken. I come and thought of the ideas to solve such a problem. So finally, I came up with a Save Rights. Save Rights is an app, Android app, to improve on the security of the people who use that brother.
I ended up doing coding because I usually like being unique and I like doing unique things in my life.
My life has really changed and I benefited that at least I'm in school, I'm doing something, I'm building my mind. Right now I'm confident. It has helped me.
I get more opportunity. Like today in Uganda, most times if you go to look for a job, they ask you, do you know computer skills? You say, no, I don't know. Oh, I know. Like they hire those people who know.
And we got some very interesting results. So 78% of people in Uganda are below 30 years old, and 60% of them, there's a huge majority of them unemployed. So some of them have never looked at a computer before, they've only dreamed about it, there's no industry for them to work in because of a civil war. So we wanted to personalize their educational experiences and make it as easy for them as possible to learn. They are in the section called Disadvantaged Youth, according to Uganda. And this is how they currently work. And they work at a local partner called the Smart Factory. And that's where we could hold our boot camps online and teach them online with a big TV in their system and a microphone so they could hear. And some of them ended up creating their own websites at the end. They all have LinkedIn now. And the goal now is to scale up the program to be longer than 3 weeks and make it into a few months, a 3 to 6 months program, so they can build their very own applications. And this is one of the students who actually was in a design thinking workshop. She was asked to find out the problems in her city. And she saw that one of the bigger problems with these taxi drivers called Buddha Buddha were getting killed. They weren't sure about who was actually going to be safe when they were getting a ride. So their customers killed them, actually. So the app she developed was called Safe Rides. And that was a way for, it's like kind of Uber, but for a safety reason, safety purpose. She said that the Buddha Buddha are now using this application. So it's a very interesting approach how you can leapfrog a part of a nation into using technology to see what can actually happen. And they don't have to go through that expensive pollution era that we went through, such as oil. They can just go straight into building applications and building industries around that.
Neural networks, a subset of deep learning within AI, is one of the most commercially used algorithms in today's industry. Unfortunately, one of the main challenges is to intuitively understand it, so it can be applied in a more effective way and evolve our applications of it. To solve this problem, Digit Academy created a highly interactive data science bootcamp within neural networks. We asked industry professionals what they think about the course and why they're taking it today.
It's not. It's, I thought that as well. That was my intuition until I took these courses. But it's basically just math and rules. And once you understand intuition behind how you use different math concepts, and once you understand the bits and pieces, then it's not complex, it's just a calculation. So, and then after that, it's just about how you want to apply that.
totally the opposite of how the other courses I took, because they used to show like a lot of algorithms and the outputs of it, but never understand the nature or what happened inside and the mathematics of it. They maybe only show the function and some examples, but never understand like how it happened and even the matrix multiplication or very basic stuff that we saw on the course today. And like, I really like the matrix multiplication with diagrams and images and videos, like very vision. That if I would learn algebra 10 years ago like that, I would probably still remember and know how to use it properly.
There will be more and more use cases, and models will be more and more complex. So to start early, learning the technology from the bottom up and the basic principles of technology, I think that's really important for actually knowing how to implement the technology and using the technology in a ethical and safe way.
And we'll just go to the next slide. And we also teach neural networks, data science. So if that's of interest as well, we've been doing this for the past year. We've taught various companies from Every, Accenture, and many more. And if you're interested, we have a free workshop coming up. And one of the workshops is going to be taught by someone who's worked in collaboration with Spotify and now works in Meta. And it's going to be how you can detect cancer. It's a novel methodology of detecting cancer, and will be taught in a very straightforward and stimulating personalized way. And the architecture looks a little bit like that. You get, at the end, 96% to 98% world-class accuracy of detection. This scientist actually won top 5 prize in creating this a few months ago at Kaggle. So if you're interested, just tap into the bit.ly link and we'll offer you a free course and workshop. And even if you're a beginner in computer science, or maybe you want to learn more about blockchain, just have a look at this and we'll provide you something free and you won't regret it. And maybe you'll understand exactly how Facebook and Amazon are using our data and find ways to circumvent that. So if you're interested, please just have a look at this link. Any questions before we end the presentation? Yes?
I have one question. When you're looking at the, when you were describing earlier all of these different boxes and how it currently works, I think you mentioned at some point that people had to have their own servers.
Yeah.
Does that mean that each individual would have to have their own server to transmit data?
So this is one of the problems with the full blockchain system for the web, but there's a lot of solutions around this. I mean, although everyone already has a server, we all have laptops, right? We all have servers. You could make a very easy way to create a decentralized system for everyone so that you don't have to know how to create your own server. So it's probably going to be a very easy solution around that. We just haven't come to it yet. That's a great question. Yes?
Okay, so it's supposed to be decentralized, right? Blockchain? But what about like the big actors? Like 2, 3, 4 companies which control like the bigger part of the centralized network. You know what I mean? Because we have these miners, the big companies, which basically control, so it's kind of centralized again. The blockchain. You know what I mean?
So you're saying if we use decentralized system, then it's going to be monopolized again, and some other big company will just take over?
Yeah, I mean, right now, like, how many, who controls, like, the network traffic in blockchain now? Like, if you look at the on the percentage, it's like five companies. It's like 1 million people who does this. From my knowledge, it's actually some few companies which kind of control, like, the majority of the traffic.
So just as there are, you know, regulations within the kind of resources that Simon pointed out, like gold, for example, there need to be regulations for blockchain as well. But the biggest problem with the centralized system is the ideology behind it. It's hierarchy by nature. Whereas a decentralized system is more of a community by nature. So, of course, there will have to be regulations. You can't have someone owning more than 51% of a blockchain, you're right. But the system, I believe, is the biggest problem. Yeah, it avoids the hierarchy.
Yeah, so I was just thinking, like, if there's going to be a solution to avoid this centralization.
Yeah.
Yeah.